Hello, YouTube. This is Matt Pullen, and welcome to another episode of How to Fail at Chess. Okay, just kidding. Let's play another 15-minute pool game. Alright, my rating is down to like 1800-something, so it should be... Alright, I'm playing a 1752, and I'm with white pieces, so... Let's play with... Let's go to d4. So this should be a significantly easier game than the one I just played. Alright, so French defense. What do I want to do here? Knight c3. Let's go knight c3. I will welcome the Winawa or the Classical or whatever he plays, so. Standard approach is to play knight e2 and then a3. But in this game, I think, let's see, should I exchange on him? Exchange and bishop d3? Sure, why not? Capablanca liked it, so it can't be that bad. Oh, he takes with queen. Well, now I have a potentially big center. Well, what do I do with it? Do I play a3 and try and get him to, you know, commit to the trade right away? Or do I play, like, I don't know, I don't trust queen g4 here. Knight f3 would be the obvious choice. Sure, let's develop. So... he's going to end up with a structure where he's got pawns on like maybe c6 or even e6, I have a pawn on d4. And I got to show that my center in the long term is worth it. Of course, there's also the tension bishop b4 and knight on c3. I can play a3, but at this point he'll probably like retreat to e7. So, one idea is to play bishop e3. The idea is queen to see how do I get. I don't want to commit a square for this yet. Maybe I can play g3 and bishop g2. Is that terrible? Or do I want to play a3 first? That would force him to exchange because if he retreats the bishop, his queen is hanging. a3 and then he doubles my pawns. Yeah, okay, let's go for that. Of course, he could play queen e4 check, I suppose, but that doesn't do much for him. After I just play like bishop e3. So he's probably going to play with c5, try and, you know, weaken my c-pawns even further. So I probably want to play bishop e3 to stop any queen e4 check, and then playing pawn to c4. Or another possible idea is to play g3, bishop g2. So I think I like bishop e3 here. Also supports maybe a capture on c5. So, bishop e3, and if he plays knight g4, I'll just let him take. On e3. Bishop e3, and then if he plays bishop e7, I'll play mate pawn to c4. Yeah, I'm not familiar with the theory of queen takes d5, but I have two bishops, I have double pawns, this position is interesting. So pawn to c4, if he plays queen a5 check, is that a big deal? He's gaining access to the e4 square there. So one option is to play bishop d3 to, you know, contest the e4 square and then castle kingside. Maybe queen e2 to follow that. Or I can play queen d2 followed by c4. Oh, queen d2 just runs into knight e4. You might play knight e4 anyway, attacking the c3 pawn. Hmm. Maybe I just want to sacrifice my c3 pawn. Bishop d3, and then castles. And if he plays knight e4, I'll let him take on c3. That is a strong possibility here. g5. Does g5 do anything? Not really, because I'm hitting it twice. So another possible move, queen e2 for me. Maybe I want to do a minority attack, a4, a5. Try and create queenside pressure. Okay, he wants to play... If I castle, he'll play like knight g4 and try and checkmate me. You know, knight g4, probably bishop takes f3, queen takes h2, so I don't want to do this. Knight e5 is a move. If he plays queen takes, then... Knight e5, queen takes queen, king takes, bishop takes g2. See, bishop takes g2, and if I play rook g1, he has bishop f3 check. That's a problem. Oh, no, he doesn't, because my knight is on e5. I mean, very basic visualization problems here. If I play knight e5, my knight is still going to control f3, so he doesn't have any bishop check. Yes. Visualization for the win. All right, knight e5, if he plays queen takes, I take with, maybe I want to take with rook. I don't know, I kind of like the idea of keeping my rook on a1 so I can play, you know, a4, a5. So I take with king, and then if he takes on g2, I play rook g1. Can he move his queen anywhere else if I play knight to e5? He can play queen h4, maybe. But then I should be able to just if he plays queen h4, knight e5, queen h4. Huh. Maybe I can just castle there, even though he's got a bishop pointing down the diagonal. Castle followed by f3. Knight 5, queen h4, h3. g3, followed by queen, followed by king b2. That looks interesting. So knight 5, queen h4, g3, queen h3, king d2. Huh. That's, I don't know, let me go for this anyway, because it's the only move I'm looking at. Knight 5, if he trades queens, I'm taking king. Alright, so we didn't play that queen h4 move. I guess I could have just went back to f3. But no. Anyway, so if he plays bishop takes g2, I have rook g1, and his g7 pawn is loose. Maybe he'll castle there. He'll castle here, and I can just play like... If he castles, I can play f3, or I can play king e2, because bishop takes g2, rook g1. Bishop moves somewhere, then bishop h6. Oh, but then he just guards it with knight e8. So if he castles, I have to play f3. Alright, knight d2. I have bishop b5 here. But then I might have to give up my bishop here. So you play f4 here, I guess. No, f4, knight takes, pawn takes, knight g4, that's bad. I don't want to let him trade on e5. Alright, so I'm going to grab on d7 and then play f3. f3, you might play knight d5. Oh, yeah, because his king is still Or I could play bishop, bishop b5 check first. And then go back to bishop d3. My problem is f3, knight d5. You can just play bishop d2. Huh. The alternative, what is the alternative? King e2? Or bishop b5 check with c6. See, if he plays... The main problem is him playing knight d5. What if I play c4 to stop that? c4... Bishop. No, he has bishop takes g2 because I'm not guarding f3 anymore. So I have to play like f3 or king e2 here. King e2, bishop takes, rook g1. Play the bishop back and then I grab on g7. I don't really like that, because you can play like bishop, you know, goes to f3 and that, or if you play like bishop h3 and try and cut off my rook. But I'm guarding any. So king e2, is he really going to take on g2 and allow me to activate my rook? Oh, let's find out. Knight d5 would be this other obvious choice. And then I think I play bishop to d2, followed by c4 to kick that knight away. Bishop takes g2, I play rook g1. Otherwise, I'm going to play f3. Maybe. Alright, so he's guarding g7 now, so I have to play... I can't allow him to take on g2 anymore. Is he really planning on pushing his kingside pawns? Is that his idea? Guarding the c3 pawn and preserving my bishop. The idea now is to play c4, gain space and deny him the d5 square. I don't know, I don't think it's a bad move, this queen takes d5. It's just e takes seems more principled. All right, so he wants to play. His idea is he wants to play knight f4 check, and if I take, he'll play g takes, open up the g file for his rook. Well, we don't want that, so let's play g three. Of course, if g three, then he can. If g three can push g four, try and undermine my long diagonal. I think that's a lesser evil there. So g4. I'm taking the mean g4 with... Well, if I play bishop e4, he is f5. I didn't consider that. So g4 presents a problem for me. G4 is his best move here, undermining the support of the long diagonal. Maybe I have to play rook f1 there. Rook f1, and then... Yeah. See, I was going to play bishop e4 here, but then I think he plays f5. That's rather embarrassing. I guess I could just take. f takes g. And then if rook takes, rook f1. The only other thing I see, rook f1, g takes, rook takes. Rook f1, g takes, rook takes. Knight takes, bishop takes, takes, takes. I end up with, oh, that's just wins an exchange. Takes, rook f1, takes, rook takes. Knight takes, check, bishop takes. Bishop takes, king takes. That's not acceptable. So, just got a take here. All right, I'll take here, and then if he doesn't check me with the knight, I'll just I'll move my rook. That seems simple. Rook f, follow up with moving the rook to f1. May put the rook on f2 to guard against my h pawn being attacked. This is. Yeah, this is not how I imagine this going. Alright, I can still play c4. That is still in the position. c4, he moves his knight somewhere, and I play bishop c3. Or I can play bishop b5 check. That doesn't do anything here. I have to pick up the pace here. He's got 10 minutes, and I have like 3 minutes and 20 seconds. So I'm going to follow up with bishop to, or I can play d5, because if he takes bishop f5. And then I'm also threatening bishop c3, you know, pinning the knight on f6 to his other rook. That is a good find. Okay. Let's see. See, if I take, he plays rook takes check. And then he can take on d5. So I can play... I can check, and if he plays king takes, what do I have there? I guess I can just play like bishop e3 and wait. Oh no, then he takes my d pawn. Oh, but his f pawn's also hanging. Bishop e1, if bishop e3 makes a check available to him on c3. Alright, I have to remove that pawn. There's a liability there. So that my strategy of trying to exploit the diagonal did not work out. I've seen things that were not at all in the position. Takes, and then, I don't know, rook f4, maybe? Bah. I have to play faster. And I guess he could take on d2. He takes on d2. I think I want to play rook take, but not relevant anymore. So bishop takes. Sure. Keep my pawns healthier. Of course, I've got some bad pawns as it is. Alright, so maybe rook d1 would be a disaster. Alright, if I push a4, he plays a5, and now my a4 pawn might be weak. Oh, but I could always exchange it. So, push So now's the time I want to push a4 to a5, try and do a minority attack. His king has not moved, so he's not threatening any discoveries or anything. If he moves his king, I think I want to play, like, king f1, so he doesn't have any discovered attacks. If he plays b5, I play a6. If he takes, I play... Do I want to play... No, I have to avoid the discovered attack. So... I can play a6 here. Maybe drop some bishop back, or I can just trade. Try and open up a file for my rook to do something. So I'm creating a pin. This might lead to an opposite bishop draw. Oh, if I try and trade it from the off, I have a weak pawn on c4 that you can play bishop a6 and try and clean up. But still, I should be able to draw that. Yeah. I don't know. Let's attack that bishop. Come back here, threatening to simplify on e4. Alright. Let's threaten a discovered attack of our own. Now we'll take and play. He can't rook take because of rook d6 check, I believe. Oh, I'm threatening that anyway. Rook d6 check, and then he has to play king c7, and I have a discovered attack. So, a tactic has miraculously appeared in the position. So, d6 check, and I have a discovered attack, and I can move my rook anywhere I want. So let's move here. Rook check. So what will we do here? Oh, it's kind of desperate. Let's grab this. He'll probably grab on c2. And I want to guard my... What will he do here? Play for time, probably. Check and grab this. He's on light squares. So as long as I stay on the dark squares, he cannot harm me. He cannot play any annoying checks. So, pre-move for the win. Why is he still playing this out? Which way will he go with his king? And that is why pre-move is a good thing. Anyway, up to 1928. That was much more difficult than it. probably should have been. This position, I felt like he had a positional advantage, but he walked into this, the rook d6, and that was what did him in. And then the further sacrifice is just, he doesn't want to play defensively, so he just gives up an exchange and plays for tines. It's not mature chess, but, you know, it's online play, so you're going to see that. Anyway, thanks for watching, and have a nice day.